What's up, MetaNerdz? This video is all about the heavily modified Acclamator-class assault ships that were turned into a line of Imperial cargo ships. In fact, it is only known by the name Imperial Cargo Ship, but it of course was manufactured by Rathana Heavy Engineering, the subsidiary of Kuat Driveyards, which supplied the Republic and the Empire with their walkers and capital ships. Its cost is unknown, but it was most likely cheaper than the Acclamator 1, since it lost its ridiculous Bounty Hunter level Class 0.6 hyperdrive for the more reasonable Class 2 hyperdrive, which was found in Imperial-class Star Destroyers. It also removed nearly all of its weaponry, from 12 down to just 2 quad turbolaser batteries, lost the proton torpedoes entirely, and instead of 24-point defense laser cannons, it only had 2 light-point defense laser cannons. It was slower, going from a top atmospheric speed of 1,200 kilometers per hour, or 746 miles per hour, which is faster than an X-Wing and an ARC-170, and tied with a TIE fighter, down to 980 kilometers per hour, or 609 miles per hour, right with the Venator and the ISD. Its crew increased 20-fold, from 700 up to 14,857, which means moving cargo around must have been a very labor-intensive job, or what may be more accurate, is that these ships had to be overstaffed because Palpatine's militarized propaganda guaranteed jobs and brought steady streams of new recruits. It might have been boring, but I think getting stationed on a cargo ship may have been better than just being sent out as cannon fodder on Mimban. The need for an assault ship that could drop off hordes of mechanized beasts was not really necessary, so many of the leftover Acclamators lost their entire complement, but did retain the trooper barracks, keeping a 16,000 stormtrooper capacity. Instead of all the ATTEs, SPHAs, and LAAT gunships, it just went with a massive cargo capacity of 502,212 tons. This would be enough to carry 8.4 Zillow Beasts, 627,765 Dubaks, or 125,553 Banthas. To have a comparison from Earth, the largest cargo ship, the OOCL Hong Kong, is about half the length of the Acclamator and could carry around 197,000 tons, so even if you scaled it up and made these two ships about the same size, the Acclamator could still carry about 100,000 tons more. As for its history, once the Separatist threat had been eliminated, and the Empire started to ramp up its resource raping of Outer Rim planets, they worked in a lot of changes both internally and externally. The loss of this entire hyperdrive section just shows how much extra tech was needed to hit that Class 0.6 speed with a ship that is this large, and to make sure that any threats could be quickly relayed to Imperial Command. Dramatic changes to the bridge were made, with a series of communication arrays located here, while the actual design of the bridge was widened to give the crew a better visual of their surroundings. The purpose of these bulbs is unknown, perhaps shield generators or escape pods, though this picture may point to them being the turbolasers and point defense batteries. But there is also this shot of X-Wings flying right over these areas. Perhaps some Imperials were just sleeping on the job, or the guy who chose not to fire on the CR-90's escape pods got demoted and transferred out to one of these ships. And this point isn't mentioned in the lore, but just looking at it, I get a lot of Separatist ship vibes, and these ships look more like a mix of an Acclamator and a Providence or a Munificent, so I wonder if leftover CIS ships were stripped apart and worked into other builds. Definitely let me know what you guys think about this in the comments down below. This would also explain how the Acclamator got these structures that extended from the ventral side, which were either clamps, allowing it to be more secure at ports, or attached to other ships, or it was just a sort of hangar bay. In Zero ABY, the same year as the destruction of the first Death Star, the Rebellion found themselves seriously low on supplies, motivating the Rebel Alliance to launch a daring raid on an Imperial cargo ship convoy. Only a pair of TIE fighters were escorting these ships, which were quickly dispatched by Luke and Wedge, followed up by a raiding party led by a clone trooper named Abel, who was now leading an elite special forces group in the Alliance intelligence, who attacked their Frankenstein ship, the YM-2800, which looks to be a spacefaring combination of an ATTE and an HMP droid gunship, right to the top of the cargo ship's bridge. Breaching the ship, they drop in and quickly subdue the crew. And I think it's safe to say that they must not have been carrying that maximum 16,000 stormtrooper complement. Though they were able to capture these four vessels, one of the crew must have taken advantage of those long-range hyperspace communication arrays, because soon after, Vader and a fleet of Star Destroyers burst out from hyperspace. Several ships were blown apart, and massive damage was done to the modified Providence class, named the Rebel 1, though it was just barely able to make it through hyperspace. Not all of the cargo was lost, and these supplies were crucial to fueling the rebellion only months after the destruction of the first Death Star. So that's it for its history, and the only behind-the-scenes fact is that it appeared in Star Wars Rebellion, My Brother, My Enemy comic book arc, which span issues 2, 4, and 5. So that's it for the Acclamator-turned-Imperial cargo ship, but most important of all, remember, TIE fighters are cheap, so make sure your cargo has a proper escort, and the Force will be with you. Always.